I never really had a title. Some people say, oh, it's Chicken Paul. I'm kind of noted as the chicken guy. I say both my research is Darwinian because I work with variation. My career has been the same thing. It just more or less evolved.
And, you know, just another day in paradise for him. You know, that's where he wanted to be, and that's, you know, it's just the way it is.
If you were a geneticist, you knew about the lions at Virginia Tech, and thus you knew about Paul Siegel.
I grew up around chickens. I have a picture on my desk when I was 3 years old. I find them very enjoyable just to be around, to observe. They have personalities. It's really relaxing for me. We had white chickens, we had chickens with brown feathers, and I never could quite figure out why sometimes when the eggs would hatch, they'd have white ones, would have red ones, and this and that. So it really intrigued me as to what was happening. I didn't know anything about genetics. I just knew I was going to go to college because I was going to breed chickens. When people ask me, what got you into chicken genetics? And I tell them, I like chickens, I like variation, and I enjoy it, and I'm getting paid for it. And they look at me like I'm crazy. I mean, there's so many other things. How can a guy want to do this type of a thing and enjoy it? I was very lucky that I was in an ag school, because when I first came, I had hatch funds, and that got me started. And then they also had the regional research projects from the USDA. I was part of the regional research project on poultry genetics. I'm an experimentalist. If I want to breed a big chicken, I'm going to go work for a company. I'm in a university, and I want to know why some are big and why some are small.
He had an idea at the start of his career, which was to create specialized genetic lines that were selected in different directions. High body weight, low body weight, strong immune response, weak immune response, and to conduct selection on the birds every breeding season over a period of time with the intent that he was going to study those birds. And he did study those birds over the course of decades of research.
If you take the average of the low weight and the average of the high weight at selection age, 8 weeks, it's 12-fold difference. I'm trying to get an understanding of the biology and to train people that can go out and do these other things.
Stuck with that idea over time for his own research, but then he allowed anybody who wanted to collaborate and make use of the genetic lines to explore their specific question. That's a gift. That's a remarkable thing.
Paul is certainly a mentor to me. I mean, he taught the students how to think. Not what to think, but how to think. And the students that he trained during that period of time I was there have all been quite successful.
The genetic lines are definitely a foundation to understand many fields: nutrition, growth, development, health, animal welfare. We are our genes and we are what we eat. So that's the contribution, is kind of understanding the basics, the fundamental tenets of how organisms grow and develop. There's a protein source of enormous importance around the world. And he has a huge appreciation for basic research and applied research.
Other people have taken what I've done and done the production, but somebody's got to lay the groundwork. I think that the work that I did had an impact on food production throughout the world and on science throughout the world, feeding people. The federal government has to support this type of work because it lays the basis for what's going on. Not only for the research, But for somebody like myself, who's trained a lot of graduate students that have gone to other universities, that have gone into industry, without that, I wouldn't have been able to do it. The only job interview I ever had was the one here. I'm looking back from 1935, the time I was 3. That's all I ever wanted to do, and I ended up getting paid for it. You know, I'm a pretty lucky guy.